Good morning, friends, and welcome to Hope from the Hill, the weekly broadcast of the Cedar Street Baptist Church of God. I'm Anthony Chandler, and I'm delighted that you're joining us today. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 13, God says, I want you to be the head and not the tail. You should be above only and not beneath. Listen, you are about to enjoy the five-star worship experience that we experience here every Sunday at Cedar Street. So don't you change this channel. You are about to be blessed. Brother Matthews, in 1886, Carl Benz drove his first automobile through the streets of Munich, Germany. He named his car the Mercedes-Benz after the name of one of his customers whose daughter's name was Mercedes. When the car first hit the road, neighbors complained because they said it was too noisy and scared the children and the horses. And now, over 130 years later, a car that was once the noisiest vehicle on the road is one of the best looking cars and best riding cars you'll find. I have not had the chance to ride in many cars that ride better than a Lexus or Toyota, but the Mercedes-Benz is not too far behind. Lexus and Toyota members just got happy all of a sudden again. The Mercedes-Benz is a nice car to ride in, and when it's really cleaned, it turns heads. I always wanted a Mercedes-Benz, and a few years ago, I saw one that fit in my budget. It's now 10 years old, but it's the car I love driving the most. My first car, Reverend Pate, was purchased in August of 1994, just weeks before I was to begin my senior year at Virginia Union. It was a 1992 four-door black Honda Civic with tan vinyl seats, a sunroof, cassette tape radio, and I purchased it with less than 35,000 miles. It was my first car, and you couldn't tell me nothing. It was a Honda Civic, but to me, it drove like a Mercedes-Benz. I kept that mug clean because I just believe that when God gives you a gift, you ought to take care of it. That's another sermon for another day, but it drives me crazy when I see how people don't take care of the blessings that God gives to them. But just know this, y'all, the Lord gives and the Lord will take away. Somebody say, I know that's right. I loved that car, Elder Street. I had a car payment and monthly insurance costs that I live for right now. I love that car. And I'll never forget what the salesman at Richmond Honda told me when I purchased the car. He said, Anthony, I know this is your first car, but he said, young brother, this car will last you forever if you make sure that you get an oil change every 3,000 miles. Trust me, that's exactly what I did. The first oil change, Anthony, was free, so I took it back to Richmond Honda to be serviced, and the second time when I called to schedule, they gave me the cost, and I was like, wow, that's expensive. Too expensive for my budget. I was a full-time college student and the youth pastor at a little country church, but I remember seeing a Jiffy Lube not too far from my treehouse apartment, and they had a 1999 special. Don't act like y'all don't know what I'm talking about. It was a 1999 special, which was within my budget. And what I liked about Jiffy Lube was that they offered you more than just an oil change. Deacon Scott, they vacuumed the inside of your car, checked the pressure and all four of your tires. They wiped the windows. No matter how clean your filter looks, they always try to persuade you to purchase a new one. You had free coffee inside, and they even put a sticker in your window so you'd know when to return. Don't look at me like you don't know what I'm talking about. A few weeks ago, while riding my used 10-year-old Mercedes, I recently discovered that there was no sticker in the corner of my front window. And with all that I have taken place in my life and on my mind, church, I honestly did not remember the last time I had my oil change.
So I called Mercedes-Benz of Richmond and asked my service advisor. I said, Gary, it's been a while. I don't remember the last time I had my oil changed. Gary said, Chandler, don't worry about it. You're fine, because with your model of Mercedes-Benz, you don't have to come in every 3 months or every 3,000 miles. No, sir. Based on the amount of driving you do, your car only needs to be serviced once a year. He said, you're actually good until July. And I was like, cool. But then I made the mistake, Lady C, and asked him, well, how much will the oil change on my 10-year Mercedes-Benz cost when I return to you in July? Can I say, friends, sometimes we just need to know when to hang up the phone. Because, friends, in July, I'm not just due for an oil change, but I'm due for one of those 60,000-mile services. And, friends, when he told me how much my annual oil change and my 60,000-mile service will cost me, I'm not even going to stand in this pulpit and tell you a lie saying that I almost cussed. No, when I heard what he said, a word came out of my mouth that wasn't holy. Don't look at me like that, because I ain't the only one who sometimes uses. And I don't know how many of you can agree with me, but having your oil change is not an inexpensive endeavor, but it will cost you something. Somebody scream, it will cost you something. I took my son's car to Jiffy Lube a few months ago, and if you've been to Jiffy Lube lately, you already know that they will offer you one of three types of services. Now, please don't use this sermon as a guide for your next oil change, because many of you already have a hookup from your boy Bubby from around the corner who will change your oil and even put a bootleg inspection sticker in your window. Preach, Pastor Chandler. So I'm not trying to mess up the good thing you got going on. But for the purpose of sermon development, and please stay with me, because I believe that this sermon will land somewhere. But when you visit Jiffy Lube, either they will offer you their more affordable conventional oil change, which is their bare basic service, or their specialty blend, which is the mid-level, the basic with some extras, or they will offer you the premium oil change service that comes with all of the bells and whistles. Now, for the purpose of affordability or choice, some buyers will settle, Deacon Greer, for the cheapest, most inexpensive oil change service that has been made available. Others will choose the mid-grade, which is certainly not the better brand, but is a step above the lesser one. But then there are those, like the people who I believe are in this room today on this Memorial Day weekend, who are in church today saying that you are in a season of your life where you can't afford to settle for the basic in anything that you do. Somebody scream, I can't do basic. No, I can't do basic, and you can't either. You can't afford to settle for basic. You can't settle for average, which is a little more than the basic, but a few steps below the best. But is there anybody at the 11 a.m. service who feels like helping me preach and say that you are in a season in your life where you've declared that I'm not settling for anything less than everything? Let me say it again. I'm not settling for anything less than everything. I want my 40 acres and the daggone mule. I want everything that God said that I can have. I want to be blessed in the city, and I want to be blessed in the field. I want to be blessed going out, and I want to be blessed coming in. I want God's premium blessings. If I got a witness in church today, I want God's premium blessings, because the conventional, the simpler, the easy way hasn't gotten most of us far anyway, has it? Nelson Mandela said, there is no passion to be found in settling for a life that is less than the one you are capable of living. And I don't know who needs to hear this, but how long will you live beneath the opportunities God has already established for your life? I want you to read read Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 13 when you get home, because there the word of God says that you should be above only. Did y'all hear what I just said? Or you're going to look at me like you don't understand the words that are coming out of my mouth. The Bible says that you should be above only. Somebody scream only, only, only. Yes, above only and not beneath. I wish I knew who I was talking to today, but this is a season for you to stop settling for the crumbs. This is the season to stop settling for what's left over. Stop settling for that which no one else wants. Stop settling for things that are no longer desired. Stop settling for the things that people who don't have nothing want you to have. Stop settling for being the side piece or the after dark, the light, or somebody who loves the tricks that you do, but they don't care about who you are. Somebody needs to declare, no more crumbs, no more crumbs. Give me the whole loaf or nothing at all. Give me what I desire and what I deserve, or I'm walking out the door. Treat me with respect, or I'm on to the next one. Appreciate and value me for what I bring to the table, or there's going to be an empty seat at this table. Somebody needs to declare, I've been dealing with months for the last 5 months of this year. I've been dealing with crumbs for the last 5 months of this year, and today it stops today. Somebody scream today. Can I share with somebody that settling for crumbs doesn't keep you fed, it keeps you starving. Let me say it again. Settling for crumbs, it doesn't keep you fed, it keeps you starving. Can I put it where you can get it? Bums settle for crumbs. Preach, Pastor Chandler. Bums settle for crumbs. Desperate people settle for crumbs. People who've lost hope settle for crumbs. People with weak faith settle for crumbs. People who just want to be in a relationship settle for crumbs. It's amazing to me how some people will settle for anybody just to say they got somebody. The devil is a liar. But today, on this Memorial Day Sunday Eve, there are people in this room who really don't need to memorialize a thing, but you need to eulogize and put a benediction on lowered standards and average living. Stop trading the ultimate for the immediate. Let me say it again. Stop trading the ultimate for the immediate. Sometimes you just got to know what you deserve, and then baby, you got to wait on it. And when certain opportunities come, you got to look at it and say, that's not it. It looks good, but it ain't enough. He has a smile, but he don't got no job. She got looks, but she don't got no brains. He has pretty teeth, but he hates going to work. They want me, but they can't afford me. You gotta know when to fold your arms, shake your head, and say you are not qualified. Am I talking to anybody, friends? Sometimes you just have to wait, and while you are waiting, you gotta worship until God opens the door. While you are waiting, you gotta worship until he makes a way. While you are waiting, you gotta worship until he provides. Look at somebody and say, you gotta disqualify some of the people in your circle. I need for somebody in this room or somebody listening to the sound of my voice to rediscover your value. Yes, you need to rediscover your value. When you wake up in the morning, you ought to look in the mirror and say, I am valuable. Who am I talking to? Yes, you are valuable. I don't care what they've been telling you. You are valuable. Yes, no matter what you did, you are valuable. You are valuable. Yes, you are, because you is kind and you is smart and you is important. You may not live in London, but you are royalty, baby. Who am I talking to? You are the head and not the tail. You are above only and not beneath. You are fearfully and wondrously made. You were crafted with beauty and purpose. You were not an accident. You were not a mistake. You were not created to replace anybody else. You are God's masterpiece. And when God made you, he said, that that right there is absolutely, hands down, the best thing I've ever made. Come on, look at somebody and say, he's talking about me right there. Am I preaching to anybody in here who can just reach over and look at somebody and say, God made me? Yes, he did. He made me different. He made me unique. He made me incredible. He made me marvelous. He didn't make another me because he knew that one of me was more than the world could handle. And I don't know why God is leading me in this direction, but for somebody in this room, God told me to tell you that this is the season for you to just love the skin that you are in. This is my going today. Come on, look at somebody and say, love the skin that you're in. Love. You gotta love the skin that you're in. Even if it's cracking, you gotta love it. Even if it's aching, you gotta love it. Even if it's aging, you gotta love it. Even if it's faulty and failing, you gotta love it. Even if it's broken and scarred, you gotta love it. Even if it's sagging, you gotta love it. Even if it still has some issues and some secrets and some mysteries, even if nobody else wants to love you or look at you, learn how to love the skin that you are in. Am I talking to somebody in church? And I don't know who needs to do this, somebody needs to testify and say, I don't know why God made me like this, but I know he doesn't make any mistakes. I don't know why God chose me to go through this, but I know he won't leave me or forsake me. I don't know why I was born with this or gotta wrestle with this or gotta live this way, but I do know that his faithfulness is great morning by morning. New mercies I see. Am I talking to anybody in here? Is there anybody who can say that all I've needed, his hand has provided? Great is his faithfulness. Somebody came to church meeting and all changed, but don't you leave here with nothing less than premium. High five two people and say, I only do premium, baby. I only do premium. I don't do basic. I don't do average. I don't do mid-grade. I only do premium. In this verse, it looks like David is receiving an oil change. Look at what he says in verse 5. He says, thou anointest my head with oil. And you better believe, friends, that this is not some cheap oil. This is not the conventional stuff or the blended stuff. This is premium. Somebody scream premium. He has premium because premium deserves premium. Let me say it again. Premium deserves premium. Even with a 10-year-old car, I still only put the premium gas in my car. I can't put that low-grade gas in my car because, watch this, my car may have age, but it has not lost its name. It's still a Mercedes. It has some age, but it still holds its value. Somebody just missed that. I need some folk with some age to holler at your preacher and say, Pastor, I got some miles on this vehicle. I got some miles on this engine, but it's still good. Am I talking to anybody in here? I need somebody over 45 to just say, it's still good. It's still working. It's still turning heads. And God is still, come on, look at me and say, he's still blessing this engine. David says, he anoints my head with oil. And I guess, preachers, the relevant question today is, why is this oil necessary? Or what difference has the oil made in our lives? I'm on page 8, only got to go to 14. I'm done. David says, he anoints my head with oil. Three quick points and we're going home. Number one, you should understand, my friends, that oil comes with its share of opposition. Somebody say opposition. Yes, oil comes with its share of opposition. Everyone, friends, will not be excited about your oil. And part A of this verse, remember, David begins this verse by talking about his enemies at the table that God is preparing. God will help you deal with your enemies. Everyone will not be jumping and screaming, friends, because you are anointed. There are some people who will hate you because you've been anointed. Preach, Pastor Chandler. in 2 Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 16, when David was first anointed, when Samuel came to his father Jesse's house searching for the next king. If you remember, 7 of David's brothers were called in. It's too much feedback up here. They were called in because they were of a different breed. They had height and stature much stronger than David, but David had his own resume. He killed a lion and a bear with his own hands while his brothers were being developed on the stage. David was being developed in the back room. David was the type of player who dared to be different. He was a renegade when everyone else chose to stand for the singing of the national anthem. David said, "Until you do right by my people, I ain't doing right by your flag." And the worst thing that you can do is to send me to the locker room, because if you think that silencing me is in the locker room, on the field, is going to work, just let me go back to the locker room, because it's in the locker room where God is strengthening me. And when I come out of the locker room, I'm coming out stronger, I'm coming out wiser, I'm coming out better. Look at somebody and say, "You can send me to the locker room if you want to, but the locker room will become a prayer room and a war room. And when I come out, I'm coming out and I'm battling every demon and every imp and every devil who's been working my nerves." But David was the type of person that God wanted to anoint, because friends, God anoints renegades. Yes, renegades, people who aren't afraid to go against the ebb and flow of tradition. Renegades, people who, when it's their time to do what they've been called to do, they just do it. They forget about how unworthy they are. They forget about how unprepared they feel. They forget about what's taking place in their life. They forget about who speaks to them and who doesn't like them. But when it's their time to stand, they stand and do what they got. Am I talking to anybody in church? And some people just don't like anointed people. Let me say it like this. Some people don't like oily people. Some people don't like oily people, because people with oil, they just got it. Somebody say, "I just got it. I just got it. I wake up in the morning and I got it. I go to lunch and I still have it. I lay down at night." Somebody scream, "I still got it." People who are anointed will encounter some opposition. And if the truth be told, many of us have had to cut some folk out of our circles because they couldn't understand our premium principles. And you had to cut them off, not because you think that you are better than they are, but you cut them off because their ceiling is your floor. I think y'all get that on Wednesday. The Bible says, "As a man thinks in his heart, so is he." And I don't know who will be bold enough to agree with me today, but I make no apologies for setting high standards. Am I talking to anybody in this room? No, I don't make any apologies for setting high standards. This is who I am, and either you will rise to the occasion or you will be left behind, because the Bible says you should be the head and not the tail. Look at somebody and say, "All comes with opposition." But secondly, you need to know that oil will afford you certain opportunities. It comes with opposition, but would also, Mother Brown, serve you some wonderful opportunities. People with oil don't go looking for opportunities. People with oil don't beg for invitations. People with oil don't brown nose, kiss up, or bend over backwards for anybody. Only people don't go looking for opportunities. Opportunities, come on, talk back to me, will come looking for oily people. And please let me give you a quick lesson on the difference between being oily and just being greasy. Preach, Pastor Chandler. There's a difference in being oily and being greasy. Have you ever heard somebody pray, and at the end of the prayer, no matter how articulate it was, no matter how precise or pristine it was, at the end, nobody was moved, nobody was swayed. But then one day you heard a person with no good subject verb agreement, limited structure, and poor grammar, but by the time they got to the amen, the entire church was on fire. Have you ever heard somebody sing or a preacher? They had all the right riffs and the right runs. They were eloquent in speech and elegant in style. They were trained and prepared. But even after the last note and the last hymn was quoted, nobody was moved. But then a little oily singer came to the mic, or a little oily preacher stepped to the pulpit desk. They may not have looked like much, but by the time they were finished, you knew that God had laid his hands on them. Because when somebody with oil stands in the mic, God has a way of blessing the whole house. And you left church saying, that child got some oil on him. There's a difference between greasy people and oily people. And what I've learned since I've been in church is this: gift cannot be compared to anointing. Some people are gifted, but they don't have no oil. Y'all not talking back to me. Some people are greasy, but they are not oily. They are greasy because they've been to school. They are greasy because they've been trained. They're greasy because they've been in church all their life. They're greasy because they got the look, but they ain't got no oil on their life. And greasy people can't stand oily people. But it's the anointing that makes the difference. Some folk need to go somewhere and start all over again. Some folk need to wipe some of that grease out of their lives and ask God to give me some oil. Am I talking to anybody in church? Friends, with the oil comes some hateration. There will be people who will try their best to do what you do. They will try to lead like you lead. They will try to teach like you teach. They will try to preach like you preach and pray like you pray and sing like you sing. But at the end of the day, can we just face the facts? Some folk got it and some folk don't. But don't be mad at the folk who got some oil, because you don't understand the cost that they've had to pay for the oil, y'all not talking back, that's on their lives. I need some oily people to stand to your feet and say, you don't know the cost of the oil on my life.
Wow, what a word. I pray that the sermon blessed your life. It certainly blessed mine. I'm so happy that you joined us today. If you don't have a church home, if you don't have a pastor, I'd love to be your pastor. Come and join us. We worship here every Sunday at 7:45 a.m. and at 10:45 a.m. We're located 2301 Cedar Street in the heart of Church Hill. Until next time, I want you to remember that God's Word said you should live above only and not beneath. I love you. Have a wonderful week. Friends, I'm sure you've heard about the construction that's taking place in Church Hill. We are restoring our historic sanctuary. I'm so excited that this fall we will be in the building. We're going to have a chapel in that building, and I'm asking you to be one of our supporters. You can help us by purchasing a chair. And on each chair, it's going to have a tag which will let everyone know who purchased or who donated this chair. You can call the church office for more information. I'm hoping that you will be one of our supporters. Thank you.
Today's weekly broadcast is brought to you in part by Manning Funeral Home. Walter J. Manning Funeral Home has been providing professional and caring service to the families in our communities since 1941. They provide pre-needed and pre-planning services, as well as cremation and video tributes. Their large chapels, spacious parlors, and caring staff are all a part of a third generation carrying out a tradition of dignity and respect. Manning Funeral Home, 700 North 25th Street, Richmond, Virginia. We're there when you need us most.